Now we will start the next chapter, understanding elementary shapes. So in this chapter you will learn about the line segments, angles and the simple closed figures such as triangles, quadrilaterals and different types of triangles and quadrilaterals, and also the three-dimensional shapes such as cuboid, cube and sphere, cone, cylinder. Now first let us start with line segments. So first you will start measuring line segments. Now how to measure a given line segment? A triangle is a simple closed figure made up of three line segments, and a quadrilateral is also a simple closed figure made up of four line segments. Then what is a line segment? A line segment is a portion of a line which has two endpoints, so it has a definite length. So when it has two endpoints on either side, it must have the definite length and it has no thickness. So then how to measure, how to compare the two line segments? So first comparison by observation. If any two line segments are given, we can just observe the line segments and compare if AB and CD. If any two line segments are given, so by just observing the given two line segments, we can say which is longer and which is shorter. So if one line segment is very longer than other, or if one line segment is very much shorter than the other line segment, then only we can compare the two line segments by observation. So for example, your PQ line segment and your RS line segment, we cannot observe and decide whether PQ is shorter or RS is shorter. Now the second comparison by tracing. So here if any two line segments are given, like AB and CD, so then we have to take the trace paper and trace the line segment CD. So then the trace line segment of CD should be kept on the line segment AB. Then by observing AB and trace line segment CD, so we can say either AB is longer or CD is longer. So but here also it is time consuming to trace the given line segment, and we have to place the trace line segment on the other line segment, and we should compare both of them. So it is also difficult to compare two line segments. So then what is the other method to compare any given two line segments? Now the third one is comparison using ruler and divisor. Comparison using ruler and divider. So if our ruler has centimeters on one edge, and here 1 centimeter equals to 10 millimeters, so here our ruler will be up to 15 centimeters. Now starting from zero mark, so we take 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10, so this is 1 centimeter. So again 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. So in this way up to 15 centimeters are marked in the regular ruler. So then if you take any two line segments AB and CD, so we have to take the ruler, and the zero mark of the ruler should coincide with the end point A, and we should check so where the other endpoint B coincides with in the ruler. So for example, the length of AB is 5.4 centimeters. Then we should check again, we should measure the length of line segment CD using the ruler. So here also we have to place the zero mark of the ruler coinciding with the one of the endpoints, and we should measure so where D coincides with the ruler. So then if it is also 5.4 centimeters, then we can say that these two line segments are of equal length. So but when we observe the measurement on the ruler, so we may not observe properly, so it is also not suitable method to find the to compare any two line segments. So then we take the divider to compare two line segments. So we if PQ and RS, so any two line segments are given, first you have to place one of the pointer of the divider on the one of the endpoints means P, and open the divider and place the other pointer on the point Q. Then you have to take the opening with same, we have to take the divider with same opening, you have to place the one of the pointers of the divider on the point R and the second point on the line segment RS. So if S is out of the other endpoint, other pointer of the divider, then we can say that RS is longer than PQ. So if the other pointer of the divider is out of the point S, then we can say that RS is shorter than PQ. So in this way we can compare any two line segments. Now let us solve few problems. The first one is, why is it better to use a divider than a ruler while measuring the length of a line segment? So when you measure the length of any line segment, so why is it better to use a divider than a ruler? So when you measure the length of any line segment, so accurate measurement will be possible only by using a divider than a ruler. So we can write that accurate measurement will be possible by using a divider than a ruler. Next question, draw any line segment, say AB. Take any point C lying between A and B. Measure the lengths of AB, BC and AC. Is AB equal to AC plus CB? Now let us see this. Now we should draw any line segment AB and take any point C lying between A and B. So here C point, measure the lengths of AB, BC and AC. So now using the divider or the ruler, we have to measure the length of AC. For example, AC equal to 3 centimeters and CB equals to 5 centimeters. Then is AB equal to AC plus CB? So here AB equal to 8 centimeters. Now we can write that yes, AB equal to AC plus CB. So because AB means 8 centimeters equal to 3 plus 5. So 8 centimeter equal to 8 centimeters. Now let us see the next question. On the number line 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 with the equal intervals, the numbers are marked, and here 1 to 7 are represented by the capital letters as A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. And in this first question, verify whether D is the midpoint of AG. So we have to check whether D is the midpoint of line segment AG. Now from A to D, so 1, 2, 3 units AD equals 2, and here from D to G again 1, 2, 3 units, so AD equal to DG, therefore D is the midpoint of AG. So both are equal to 3 centimeters. Next, if B is a midpoint of AC, where AB CD lie on a straight line, say Y AB equal to CD. Now, since B is the midpoint of AC, then we can write AB equal to BC. So similarly here, C is the midpoint of BD. Since B is the midpoint of C is the midpoint of BD, so we can write that BC equal to CD. So this is equation 2. From 1 and 2, so by transitive property, so since AB equal to BC and BC equal to CD, so we can equate AB equal to CD. Now let us go to the next topic, angles. Now the different types of angles as right angle. Straight angle, and complete angle. So right angle, straight angle, and complete angle. So right angle means whose measure is 90 degrees, straight angle whose measure is 180 degrees, and complete angle in the sense, so full revolution, so it is 360 degrees. Now for example, if you are facing towards north, now if you turn through right angle, then you will see in the clockwise direction, then you will see towards the east. So if you make another turn through right angle in the clockwise direction, then you will see towards south. So then when you make two right angles, then here it is a straight angle, then you will see the opposite direction of north, that is south. So when you make one complete revolution, so then again you will see towards north. So when you make three right angles, when you turn through three right angles, then first right angle, second right angle, then third right angle, so then you will see towards west. Now let us see the anti-clockwise direction. Now for example, if you are facing towards east, now if you turn through right angle in the anti-clockwise direction, then you will face the north. And from north again, if you turn through right angle, so then you will face west. Now if you are facing the west, then if you make a straight angle, so then you will face the opposite direction of west, that is east. Now if you make one complete revolution, then again you will face towards west. Now Right angle means, so here right angle is 90 degrees by the complete revolution means 360 degrees. So we can say that 91s are 94s are, so this is 1/4 of revolution. And straight angle, so straight angle equals to 180 degrees by 360 degrees. 181s are, 182s are, 360, so this is half revolution. Now the complete angle equals to 360 by 360 degrees, so this equals to 1 revolution. And we can observe the clock. If we observe the clock, so in this clock also we 12 6 3 9 1 2 4 5 7 8 10 11. If the hours or minutes hand is facing 12 and the hours hand is facing 3, when at 3 o'clock, then the angle between the two hands is a right angle. So when the hours hand is facing 6, means at 6 o'clock, then the angle between the two hands is a straight angle, so it is 180 degrees. So at 12 o'clock, the two hands will face 12, so then the angle between them, either it will be 0 degrees or a complete angle, that is 360 degrees. So even at 9 o'clock, the angle between the two hands of the clock is right angle, 90 degrees. Now let us solve few problems based on the right angle, straight angle and complete angle. So what fraction of a clockwise revolution does the hour hand of a clock turn through when it goes from 3 to 9? So when it goes from 3 to 9, so the hour hand, when it goes from 3 to 9, so then we have to find out what fraction of the clockwise rotation. So here the angle is, so when it goes from 3 to 9, so here the angle made is a straight angle because there are two right angles, so straight angle and 180 degrees by the total angle 360 degrees, so this equals to 1 by 2. So it turns half of the revolution, so when it goes from 3 to 9 and 4 to 7. Four, five, seven, eight. Now when it goes from 4 to 7, so here it is like 3 to 6, so 4 to 7 means it is also a right angle, so then 90 degrees by 360 degrees, so it is making the right angle when it goes from 4 to 7. So 90 by the total angle at the center is 360 degrees, so 91s are, 94s are, so we get 1/4 of the revolution. Next, 12 to 9. So if you calculate, now when it is going from 12 to 3, right angle, 3 to 6, right angle, and 6 to 9, right angle. So 1, 2, 3. So when it goes from 12 to 9, it is making 3 right angles. So 3 into 90 by the complete angle 360 degrees. So 91s are, 94s are. So this equals to 3/4 revolution. Next, where will the hand of a clock stop if it starts at 12 and makes 1 by 2 of a revolution clockwise? 12, 6, 3, 9, 1, 2. Now if it starts at 12 and makes half revolution. So when it is making half revolution, means it is making 180 degrees. Half into 360 degrees, so this equals to we get 180 degrees. So when it is making 180 degrees means a straight angle, it will stop at 6. It will stop at 6. Now the next question. Start at 2 and makes 1 by 2 of revolution. Now when it start at 2 and making half revolution means, so half of the revolution means half into 360 degrees. So 2 to 180 is equal to 180 degrees. Now here it is making straight angle, then it will stop at 8. Now the next question is, which direction will you face if you start facing east and make one end of a revolution clockwise? Now north, south, east and west. Now which direction will you face if you start facing east? So start facing east and making one end of the revolution clockwise. So one and a half revolution means one revolution. So again we will face east and half revolution. So here one and a half revolution equals to 3 by 2 into 360 degrees. So 2 to 180 is 360. So 180 into 3, 540 degrees. So when you face, when you turn through 540 degrees means after one revolution you will face towards east and again half revolution, so then we'll face towards west. So then the answer is west. Now the next one is, start facing west and making 3 by 4 of the revolution anti-clockwise. North, south, east, west. Facing towards the west and 3 by 4 of the revolution. So 3 by 4 into 360 degrees. So 4 ones are 490 is 3 right angles. So 270 degrees means 3 right angles. So in the anti-clockwise direction, so one right angle towards south, one right angle towards east and another right angle towards north. So we will face towards north. Next question. What part of a revolution have you turned through if you start facing south and turn clockwise to face east? So when you are facing south and turn clockwise to face east, so to turn clockwise means in this direction to face east, so we have to turn one right angle, two right angles and three. So we have to turn through three right angles. So 3 right angles means 3 into 90 by the complete angle is 360 degrees. Out of 360 degrees, 91s are, 94s are. So we get 3 by 4 revolution. Now the next one is, if you stand facing west and turn clockwise to face east, north, south, here, east, and west. So when you face west and turn clockwise to face east. So clockwise means in this direction. So north, one right angle, towards east, another right angle. So then two right angles means 2 into 90 degrees by 360 degrees. So 91s are 94s are 360 and 2 1s are 2, 2 2s are 4. So this equals to half revolution. Now the next question, find the number of right angles turned through by the hour hand of a clock when it goes from 3 to 6. Now when the hour hand moves from 3 to 6, when it goes from 3 to 6, so then it is making only one right angle. Next, when it goes from 5 to 11, so when it goes from 5 to 11, now it is making 180 degrees, so it is making two right angles. Next, so when it is going from 12 to 9, so when it is facing towards 12 and it is moving 12 to 9, so when it goes to 3, one right angle, and when it moves to 6, two right angles, and when it moves to 9, so three right angles. So then totally it is making three right angles. Now let us see the next question. How many right angles do you make if you start facing north and turn anticlockwise to east? So when you are facing north, and in the anticlockwise direction, you are moving to the east. So then you have to find out how many right angles do you make. So when facing towards north and moving towards east, and in the anticlockwise direction, so this is the first right angle when you face towards west, and the second right angle when you face towards south, and the third right angle when you face east in the anticlockwise direction. So there are three right angles. Next, when you face west and turn to west, either clockwise or anticlockwise, north, south, east, west. So when you face west and again we are turning towards west, either clockwise direction or anticlockwise direction. So if you go to the clockwise direction, so towards north, one right angle. Towards east, when you face towards east, the other right angle, two right angles, and towards south, the other right angle, so third right angle, and when you come back to west, so another right angle. So overall four right angles in the clockwise direction. Or if you see in the anti-clockwise direction, we will find that there will be four right angles. Next question, where will the hour hand of a clock stop if it starts from 6 and turns through one right angle? So when it starts at 6, and in this we are considering clockwise direction. So when it is facing 6 and it is turning through one right angle in the clockwise direction, then it faces 9. So the hour and of the clock will stop at 9. But the next one from 10 and turns through 3 right angles. Now it is showing 10. Here also the clockwise direction, it is turning through 3 right angles. When it turns through one right angle, it shows 1, and another right angle it shows 4, and the third right angle then it shows 7. So when it turns through 3 right angles, then it will stop at 7. So therefore we can write the hour and of the clock will stop at 7. We have learnt about the right angle, straight angle and complete angle. Now let us learn about acute angle, obtuse angle and reflex angle. Now we know that right angle means it is a 90 degrees, so this is a right angle, and if you take two right angles, so then it is straight angle 180 degrees, and if you take four right angles, then it is 360 degrees. Now this is 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, then again it becomes now 360 degrees. Now the angle between 0 degrees and 90 degrees, so this is called acute angle. And the angle above 90 degrees and below 180 degrees, so this is obtuse angle. The angle above 180 degrees and below 360 degrees, so this is reflex angle. Now the acute angle is an angle whose measure is between 0 degrees and 90 degrees. Next, obtuse angle. An angle whose measure is between 90 degrees and 180 degrees. Now reflex angle, an angle whose measure is between 180 degrees and 360 degrees. Now let us solve a problem based on the types of angles such as right angle, straight angle, complete angle, reflex angle, acute angle and obtuse angle. So classify each one of the following angles as right, straight, acute, obtuse and reflex. So the first one, so this angle looks like the angle between 0 degrees and 90 degrees. So it can be classified as an acute angle. Now this angle in the second figure, it is above 90 degrees but below 180 degrees, so it is an obtuse angle. Now in the third figure, if you observe this in the letter T, so this is perpendicular, this horizontal line is perpendicular to the vertical line, so it is here the angle formed is a right angle. Next, in the fourth figure, so it is above 180 degrees and below 360 degrees, so it is a reflex angle. And in the next fifth figure, so this angle is a straight 180 degrees, so it is a straight angle. Now let us go to the next topic, measuring angles. How to measure an angle? And what are the units to measure the angle? Now the basic unit of measuring an angle is degrees. Now what is a degree? Now if you divide the complete revolution into 360 equal parts, so if you divide the complete revolution into 360 equal parts, then each part is called a degree. So in the complete revolution there are 360 degrees. So this symbol we use for representing degrees. Now to measure an angle, we have an instrument in your geometry instrument box. So that is protractor. So in this protractor, it is in the semicircular shape, on the curved edge of this semicircular shape. So there are 180 equal parts. So then 180 degrees are there along the curved shape. Now here the marking starts from left from 0 degrees to 1, 2, 3 up to on the right. It will end with 180 degrees. So again from the right, the marking starts from 0 degrees to it ends on the left with 180 degrees. Now if you want to measure an angle ABC, now this protractor is used to measure the given angles and it is also used to draw the given angles. Now if the angle ABC is given, we have to measure, then what is the angle of ABC? So then let us place the center point of the protractor with the vertex B, and we have to place this edge, straight edge along the ray BC, and we should measure the marking from right side because angle ABC is open to the right. So then we have to measure the marking from right 0, 10, 20, 30, 40. So for example, if a BA ray coincides with here 40 degrees, so then the angle ABC is 40 degrees. Now for example, if there is another angle open to the left, now to measure the angle PQR, we have to place the protractor at Q and we should place the center point of the protractor coincides with Q. Then we have to measure the marking started from left 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, and if QP ray coincides with 50 degrees from left, because angle PQR is open to the left, so we should start marking from 0, from left to 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. So then this angle measure is 50 degrees. So in this way we can measure acute angles, obtuse angles, even the right angle and reflex angles using the protractor. Let us solve few problems. Now the first question, what is the measure of a right angle and be a straight angle? The measure of a right angle is is 90 degrees and the measure of a straight angle is 180 degrees. Now this is a right angle and now this is a straight angle whose measure is 180 degrees. Now next question, write down the measure of measures of acute angle B, obtuse angle C, reflex angle. So the acute angle, in the sense it lies between 0 and 90, so 0 degrees less than x less than 90 degrees, where x is the acute angle. Now we can take 30 degrees or 40 degrees or 75 degrees. So these are all acute angles. Now these are some examples for acute angles. And obtuse angles means whose measure is above 90 but less than 180. So we can write 90 degrees less than y less than 180 degrees, where y is an obtuse angle. Then some examples for acute angles are 91 degrees, 110 degrees and 176 degrees. Next, reflex angle. So reflex angle means whose measure is above 180 degrees but below 360 degrees. So 180 degrees above, 180 degrees less than z less than 360 degrees. So we can take some examples for reflex angle. So 189 degrees comma 220 degrees comma 315 degrees. So these are all examples for reflex angle. Now let us see the next question. Measure the angles given below using protractor. And write down their measure. Now the first angle is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. Now if you measure this angle ABC using protractor, you have to place the center point of the protractor at vertex B and you should measure from marking, you should See the marking from right side, because the angle is open to the right. So then 0, 10, 20, 30, 45. So if it is coinciding with 45 marking, so angle ABC equal to 45 degrees, and it is an acute angle. Now the second one. Now, if you place the center point of the protractor with vertex Q and the ray QP showing 90 degrees on the protractor, so it is the angle PQR equals to 90 degrees, so it is a right angle. Next one. Angle LMN. So here also center of the protractor should be coincided with the PM. Then so it is, now here also we have to see from right side 0, 10, 20, 30 up to the ray ML is showing 120 degrees on the protractor. So angle LMN equals to 120 degrees. So it is reflex angle. So this is right angle 90 degrees and it is acute angle 45 degrees. Let us see the next question. Find the measure of the angle between the hands of a clock. In each of the following figure, so the first figure, now it is showing 12 and 6, 3, 9. Now it is 9 o'clock, 9 a.m. Now the angle between the two hands at 9 a.m. So if you measure with the protractor, it showing exactly the right angle. So the angle is 90 degrees and it is a right angle. Next. Twelve, six, three, nine, and it is showing 1, 2, 4, 5, 7, 8, 10, 11, and it is showing 1 o'clock, so 1 p.m. The hour sign is showing 1 and the minute sign is at 12, so this is 1 p.m. So then the angle between the two hands, so when the hour hand completes one revolution, it is making 360 degrees. Means in 12 hours, it is making 360 degrees. So then 1 hour, so 360 by 12. So 12 ones are 12, 3s are 36. So we get 30 degrees. So then at 1 p.m., the angle between the two hands of the clock is 30 degrees. Now, for example, if the hour hand is 12:6. Now the hours only showing 6 and minutes only showing 8, 12. Now the angle between the two hands is a straight angle, so it is a 180 degrees, this straight angle. So the time is 6 p.m. So it is 180 degrees and it is straight angle. Let's see the next question. Measure and classify each angle in the following figure. Now if you measure the angle AOB, now by placing the protractor at the point O, and if you measure angle AOB, so it is 60 degrees, and angle BOC, so it is 80 degrees, and angle COD, so it is a right angle, 90 degrees, and angle DOA, so it is 130. 80 plus 60, 140, 140 plus 90, 230, 230 plus 130, so it is, the total angle is 360 degrees. So then angle AOB is 60 degrees, angle BOC 80 degrees, angle COD 90 degrees, and angle DOA 130 degrees. Repeat. So this is 170 degrees. Then angle AOD 130 degrees. Actually, if you see the angle, this BD is looking like a straight angle, so some of these two angles must be 180 degrees. So let us take 90 degrees and this also 90 degrees. Now if you measure, actually you will get BOC and COD both, you will get 90. So angle BOC also 90. So then angle BOD 90 plus 90, it is 180 degrees. Now let us write the type of each angle. So the angle AOB is 60 degrees, so it is acute angle. And angle BOC is 90 degrees, so it is a right angle. And angle COD also right angle. Angle DOA, it is more than 90 and less than 180, so it is obtuse angle. Next 180 degrees, it is a straight angle. Next angle AOC 130 degrees, so it is more than 90 and less than 180, so it is also obtuse angle. Now let us see the next topic, perpendicular lines. Now when the two lines intersect, an angle between two intersecting lines is a right angle. A line L and line M, both are intersecting at a right angle. So then the two lines are said to be perpendicular lines. So if the angle between two intersecting lines is a right angle, means 90 degrees, then the two lines are said to be perpendicular lines. So if line L is perpendicular to M, if L is perpendicular to M, we write L is perpendicular to M. So this is the symbol for perpendicularity. So we write L is perpendicular to M. If the two lines AB and CD are perpendicular to each other, so then we write AB is perpendicular to CD. Now let us see the next question based on the perpendicular lines. Let PQ be the perpendicular to the line segment XY. So actually here XY, let PQ and XY intersect in the point A. What is the measure of angle PAY? So first let us draw the figure showing the given question. So PQ be the perpendicular to the line segment XY. So first let us draw line segment XY and PQ be the perpendicular to the line segment XY. PQ and XY intersect in the point A. So the line segments PQ and XY intersect in the point A. So then what is the measure of angle PAY? So the measure of angle PAY equals to 90 degrees, because the angle between two perpendicular lines is a right angle. So the measure of angle PAY is 90. So automatically all the four angles will be right angles. So angle PAX equals to 90 degrees. Angle XAQ, angle XAQ equals to 90 degrees. Angle YAQ also 90 degrees. Now let us see the next question. Study the diagram. The line L is perpendicular to the line M. So on the line L, 0 to 8 marking is given, and A to, now 1 to 8 are represented by A, B, C, D up to H. Now let us see the first question. Is CE equal to EG? So from C to E, so this is 2 units, 2 centimeters, and E to G also 2 centimeters. So we can write that yes, CE equal to EG, each 2 centimeters. The second question, does PE bisect CG? So PE means there is a point P marked on the line M. So we have to check whether PE bisects CG. So then we have to find the distance from C to E and E to G. So CE and EG both are equal. So we can say that CE equal to EG. CE equals to EG equals to 2 centimeters. So yes, PE bisects CG. Next question. Identify any two line segments for which PE is the perpendicular bisector. So PE is the perpendicular bisector means it should divide any line segment equally and perpendicularly. So then we can say that DF is the perpendicular bisector of, means PE is the perpendicular bisector of DF, because DE equal to EF. So we can say that DF is the perpendicular bisector. Next, CG is the perpendicular bisector. So already it is written there, CG is the perpendicular bisector, and also BH. So because B to E and E to H, so B to E 1, 2, 3 centimeters, and E to H 1, 2, 3 cylinders. So you can say that BH is a perpendicular. P is a perpendicular bisector of BH. Next, are these true? So first one, AC greater than FG. AC greater than FG. FG is 1 centimeter, but AC is 2 centimeters. So then we can say that AC is greater than FG. So it is true. Next, CD equal to GH. CD is 1 centimeter. GH also 1 centimeter. So both are equal. So it is also true. Next, BC less than EH. BC is 1 centimeter, B to C, less than EH. EH is 3 centimeters, 1, 2, 3 centimeters. So then 1 less than 3, so it is also true. Now let us see the next topic, classification of triangles. A triangle means it is a simple closed figure bounded by the three line segments. So how to classify the triangles based on the sides and also the based on the angles? So we can classify the triangles in three types. So based on the sides and again three types on based on the angles. So first let us classify the triangles based on the sides. First one is equilateral triangle. Equilateral triangle means a triangle in which all the three sides are equal. So then it is called an equilateral triangle. So a triangle in which all the three sides are equal. Next, see the equilateral triangle. So in this, three sides are equal in triangle ABC. AB equal to BC equal to AC. So then it is called equilateral triangle. Now the second type of triangle is isosceles triangle. So in this, a triangle in which two sides are equal. So if you take the triangle with two equal sides, then it is called isosceles triangle. Here AB equal to AC, two sides are equal. Now the third type of triangle is scalene triangle. Now a triangle in which all the three sides are unequal. So if you take a triangle ABC with all the different sides, so then it is called a scalene triangle. So equilateral triangle means a triangle in which all the three sides are equal, then automatically all the three angles will be equal. And isosceles triangle means a triangle in which two sides are equal. So if two sides are equal, then their opposite angles also will be equal. Next, scalene triangle means a triangle in which all the three sides are different, means all three sides are unequal. So then it is called scalene triangle. Now this is the classification of the triangles based on the sides of the triangle. Now let us classify the triangles based on the angles. based on angles. Now based on angles, again there are three types of triangles. First one is acute angle triangle. So acute angle triangle means a triangle in which all the three angles are acute. For example, in triangle PQR, so angle P is 70 degrees, angle Q is 60 degrees, then angle R is 50 degrees. 70 plus 60, 130 plus 50, 180, and each angle is an acute angle. So a triangle in which each angle is acute angle is called an acute angle triangle. Second one is right angle triangle. Now right angle triangle means a triangle in which one angle is a right angle. So if you take the triangle PQR, one angle Q is right angle, so it is called the right angle triangle. Now the side opposite to the right angle is the longest side. So this side is called hypotenuse. The side opposite to the right angle is called hypotenuse. Next, third type of triangle is obtuse angle triangle. So obtuse angle means the angle whose measure is above 90 degrees and below 180 degrees. Now, a triangle in which one angle is an obtuse angle. Now, if you take the triangle PQR, here angle Q is 120 degrees, so it is an obtuse angle. So this triangle is called an obtuse angle triangle. So these are the three types of triangles based on the angles. First one is acute angle triangle, means the triangle in which all the three angles are acute angles. Next, right angle triangle, the triangle in which one angle is a right angle. And the obtuse angle triangle means a triangle in which one angle is obtuse angle. Now there is another type of triangle, that is right angle isosceles triangle. So in this, two sides are equal, so it is isosceles triangle, and one angle is right angle, so it is a right angle triangle. So it is isosceles right angle triangle. Now let us solve few problems based on the classification of triangles. So name the types of the following triangles. First one, triangle ABC with AB equal to 8.7 centimeters, BC equal to 6 centimeters, and AC equal to 7 centimeters. So let us draw the triangle ABC rough figure, and here the length of AB is 8.7 centimeters and length of BC is 6 centimeters. The length of AC is 7 centimeters. The three sides are of different length. So then triangle ABC is a scalene triangle. Next, triangle XYZ with measure of angle Y is 90 degrees and XY equal to YZ. So when the measure of angle Y is 90, which is a right angle, and X here Z and here it is given that xy equal to yz, xy and yz both are equal, so it is a isosceles, because two sides are equal, so it is isosceles triangle, and one angle is right angle, so it is right angle triangle. So it is triangle xyz is an isosceles right angle triangle. Now the third one is triangle LMN with measure of angle L is 30 degrees, measure of angle M is 70 degrees, and measure of angle N is 80 degrees. L, M, N. Measure of angle L is 30, measure of angle M 70 degrees, angle N is. So here each of the three angles is an acute angle, so it is an acute angle triangle. So triangle L, M, N is an acute angle triangle. Now the next question, name each of the following triangles in two different ways. So based on the sides and based on the angles of the triangle, you have to name the each of the three triangles. So first one, according to the sides, the three sides are different, so it is scalene triangle, and no, yeah, two sides are equal, 5 cm and 5 cm, so it is isosceles triangle, and each angle is acute angle, so it is isosceles and acute angle triangle. Isosceles and acute angle triangle. Now the second one, here two sides are equal, so it is isosceles triangle, and one angle is right angle, so it is an isosceles right angle triangle. Next, here three sides are of different length, so it is scalene triangle, and one of the three angles is obtuse, so it is scalene and obtuse angle triangle. Now we will go to the next topic, quadrilaterals. A simple closed figure bounded by four line segments is called a quadrilateral. So these four line segments are called four sides of the quadrilateral. So a polygon which consists of four sides is called a quadrilateral. Now what are the different types of quadrilaterals? So first, if in a quadrilateral, if only one pair of opposite sides are parallel, then it is said to be a trapezium. Only one pair of opposite sides are parallel, so it is a trapezium. If both pairs of opposite sides are parallel, then it is said to be a parallelogram. Both pairs of opposite sides are parallel, then it is said to be a parallelogram. So it is a parallelogram. And if each angle of a parallelogram is a right angle, then it is a rectangle. So in a rectangle, opposite sides are parallel and equal, and each angle is a right angle. And in a parallelogram, if adjacent sides are equal, so then it is said to be a rhombus. Means in a rhombus all the four sides are equal, but two angles are acute and two angles are obtuse. That is a rhombus. Now in a rectangle, if the adjacent sides are equal, then it becomes a square. Means in a square all sides are equal. Or even from rhombus we can get the square. So in a rhombus, if each angle is right angle, then it becomes a square. Now in a trapezium, only one pair of opposite sides are parallel. If the non-parallel sides are of equal length, then it is said to be isosceles trapezium. Now in parallelogram, opposite sides are parallel and equal, and diagonals are not equal, and the diagonals bisect each other. And in case of a rectangle, all the four angles are right angles, equal, and the opposite sides are parallel and equal, and the diagonals are equal and diagonals bisect each other. In case of a rhombus, all the four sides are equal, and two acute angles and two obtuse angles are present in a rhombus, and diagonals perpendicularly bisect each other. But the lengths of diagonals are not equal in case of a rhombus. But whereas a square, all the four sides are equal, four angles are equal, and the lengths of diagonals are equal, and opposite sides are parallel, and the diagonals perpendicularly bisect each other. Now let us fill up the following table based on the properties of the different quadrilaterals such as parallelogram, trapezium, rectangle, square and rhombus. So we will check the different properties in the columns: opposite sides parallel and equal, and all sides equal, opposite angles equal, diagonals equal and perpendicular. So first let us take parallelogram. Now in a parallelogram, opposite sides are parallel and also equal. So opposite sides parallel, so yes, and equal, yes, and all sides are not equal. So opposite angles are equal, so we can write yes, and diagonals are not equal, and diagonals are also not perpendicular. Next, a rectangle. In a rectangle, opposite sides parallel, opposite sides equal, then all sides are not equal, and opposite angles equal, so yes, and diagonals equal, and diagonals are not perpendicular. Next, square. In a square, opposite sides parallel, opposite sides equal, and all sides are also equal, then opposite angles are equal, and the diagonals equal, and diagonals perpendicular, yes. Next, rhombus. In a rhombus, all sides are equal and diagonals perpendicularly bisect each other. So in case of a rhombus, opposite sides parallel and opposite sides equal, and all sides are equal. Next, opposite angles equal, diagonals not equal, and diagonals are perpendicular. Next, a trapezium. In a trapezium, only opposite sides are parallel. So, opposite sides parallel, so only one pair of opposite sides parallel, so we can write no here. And opposite sides are not equal, then all sides are also not equal, and opposite angles are not equal, and diagonals are also not equal, and diagonals are not perpendicular. So here only one pair of opposite sides are parallel. So one pair parallel. Now let us do few problems based on the types of quadrilaterals. Now the first one is, give reasons for the following. A square can be thought of as a special rectangle. So when a rectangle is said to be a square, a rectangle in which adjacent sides are equal. Actually in a rectangle adjacent sides are not equal. So when we make the adjacent sides equal, then it becomes a square. So we can write that the rectangle with equal adjacent sides becomes a square. Next, a rectangle can be thought of as a special parallelogram. Now if you take the parallelogram, so when a parallelogram is said to be a rectangle, so what is the difference between the parallelogram and rectangle? So if you make each angle of a parallelogram right angle, then it becomes a rectangle. So a parallelogram with each right angle is becoming a rectangle. So we can write a parallelogram with each angle of 90 degrees becomes a rectangle. Now the next one is, a square can be thought of as a special rhombus. Now rhombus, what is the difference between the rhombus and a square? In a rhombus all sides are equal, but all angles are not equal. But whereas in a square all sides and all angles are right, all sides are equal and all angles are right angles. Whereas in a rhombus two opposite angles are acute and two opposite angles are obtuse. So a rhombus with each angle of 90 degrees becomes a square. Now let us check the next question. The figure is said to be regular if its sides are equal in length and its angles are equal in measure. Now can you give an example for a regular quadrilateral? Now a figure in which a simple closed figure or a polygon in which all the sides are equal in length and all the angles are equal in measure is said to be a regular figure or regular polygon. So what is the regular quadrilateral? If you take the three-sided figure, the triangle is regular because all the three sides are equal in length and all the three angles are equal in measure. So it is a regular polygon with three sides, means equilateral triangle. But here the question is, what is a regular quadrilateral? So what is a quadrilateral in which all the four sides are of equal length and all the four angles are of equal measure? So that is a square. So in a square, all the four sides are equal and all the four angles are also equal. So this is a regular quadrilateral. A square is a regular quadrilateral. Now let us go to the next topic, polygons. So polygon means a simple closed figure consisting of line segments is called a polygon. So triangle, quadrilateral, and the different types of triangles and quadrilaterals. So these are all the examples of polygons. Now what are the other polygons? So if a simple closed figure consisting of five sides, then what is it called? Or six sides, then what is it called? So here we will write the number of sides and polygon, and here you will write illustration. Now if a polygon consists of three sides, then it is called a triangle. So this is an example of a triangle. And if a polygon consists of four sides, it is called quadrilateral. So we can draw any quadrilateral like this. And if a polygon consists of five sides, so it is called pentagon. So there are five sides in this pentagon. If a polygon consists of six sides, it is called hexagon. So there will be six sides. In hexagon. And if there are seven sides, so it is called heptagon. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And if there are eight sides, it is octagon. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. And if it has nine sides, then it is nonagon, and 10 sides means decagon. So these are the different types of polygons according to the number of sides of the polygon. So nine sides means nonagon, and if it has 10 sides, then it is called decagon. Now let us solve few problems based on the polygons. Examine whether the following are polygons. So the first figure, it is not a simple closed figure. It is not a closed figure. So it is not a polygon. The second figure, so it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it is a polygon of six sides, and it is also called hexagon. Next, it is not made up of line segments. It is not made up of line segments. So it is not a polygon. It is not a polygon. Now the second question. Name each polygon. So the first one is, it has three sides. So it is a triangle. Now the second one is, now it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it has 5 sides. So it is a pentagon. The third one. So it has 8 sides. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It has 8 sides. So it is an octagon. Now let us see the next question. Draw a rough sketch of a regular hexagon. Connect any three of its vertices. Draw a triangle. Identify the type of the triangle you have drawn. So first let us draw the rough sketch of a regular hexagon. So regular hexagon means it has 6 sides. And all the 6 sides are of equal length. So this is a regular hexagon A, B, C, D, E, F. And connect any three of its vertices. So let us connect A to E. And we will connect AC. And we will connect EC. So here AE, AC and EC, the three sides are of equal length. So then we can say that it is an isosceles triangle. So triangle AEC. Now triangle AEC is an equilateral triangle. Cut. So far you have learnt only the two dimensional shapes such as rectangle, square, rhombus, triangle, parallelogram. So these have only the length and breadth, and now we will deal with the three dimensional shapes. Now we can find out so many three dimensional shapes from our day to day life. Now if you see the brick, now it is a three dimensional shape because it has length, breadth and also height. And ice cream cone, and it is conical shape, and cricket ball, so it is round, so then it is considered as a sphere. And powdered tin, so it is in the shape of a cylinder. So these are the different examples of the three dimensional shapes. Now let us see what is a cuboid. Now let us observe a cuboid. It has length, breadth, height are different. Now if you take the cuboid, now this edge is called, this is edge, so this side is called edge, and this side portion, so this is called face. This flat surface is called its face, and where two faces meet each other, so this is called edge. So this face and this, the behind face, so these two faces meet in a line. So this is called the edge of the cuboid. and where two edges meet each other. So this point is called vertex. Now let us see a cuboid. Now this is in the shape of a cuboid. So these lateral surfaces are called faces, and the two faces meet in a line. So this is called the edge of the cuboid, and two edges meet in a point. So this is called vertex of the cuboid. Now if you take any cube, now here also it has faces, so this is edge and it is a vertex. Now let us see a cube. A cube has all the three dimensions same, because the length, breadth and height, all the length, breadth and height are the same. Now the two, so these lateral faces are called faces, and the two faces meet in a line. So this is called edge of the cube, and the two edges will meet in a point. So this point is called vertex of the cube. Now how many faces does a cube have? So let us find the number of faces. So four side faces and the top and bottom. So it has six faces, and the edges four in the top, four in the bottom and four in the sides. So it has 12, 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12 edges, and the vertices 4 in the top and 4 in the bottom. So it has 8 vertices. Now let us see some other three dimensional shapes. So a prism. Now a three dimensional shape which has triangular bases and the lateral faces are rectangles is called a prism. Now this prism has, the base of this prism is in the shape of a triangle, so it is a triangular prism. If the shape of the base of any prism is a square, then it is called a square prism. And if the base of the base is in the shape of a pentagon, so it is called a pentagonal prism. So the name of the prism depends on the shape of its base. Now next, and in case of, next one is a pyramid. And in a prism, the lateral faces are rectangles. Now pyramid. Now here the shape of the base is a triangle, and it has three lateral faces. These three lateral faces are also triangles, will meet in a point. So this type of prism is called a pyramid. So as the base is in the shape of a triangle, it is a triangular pyramid. And if the shape of the base is like a square, then it is said to be a square pyramid. Now this is a square pyramid. Next, cylinder. Now it is also a type of three-dimensional shape, a type of prism. It has two circular bases and the lateral face is like a curve. It has two circular faces and the lateral faces is in the shape of a curve. So then this is called cylinder and a sphere. So sphere means it is also a three-dimensional shape which has all the lateral faces and everything will be in the curve shape. So this is said to be a sphere. Let us solve two problems based on the three-dimensional shapes. First one is name the following figures. So in this first one is now this figure is a cuboid. It is a three-dimensional shape which has six lateral faces. Now it is a cube because all the sides are of equal length. So it is a sphere. No, it is a cone. It is a cylinder. Next one. So it is a triangular prism or triangular pyramid because one of the base is in the shape of a triangle and the other base is a vertex. So it is a triangular pyramid. Now the next question, what shape is a brick? A brick is in the shape of a cuboid. And a road roller is in the shape of a cylinder. Next, a sweet laddu is in the shape of a sphere. And an ice cream cup is in the shape of a cone.